to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The Gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and such immorality that is not even named among the Gentiles, that a man has his father's wife. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 1. Welcome to our study of the book of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians is all about dealing with church problems that are related to spiritual immaturity. And one of the problems that Paul is going to identify in chapters 5 and 6 is certain sins against the body. Sins against the human body, 1 Corinthians 5, the sins of sexual immorality, which also affected the spiritual body. And in chapter 6, he deals with sins against the body of Christ, the church, by members suing one another. And so we might entitle this section, Sins Against the Body, problems relating to that. Well, what is the problem in 1 Corinthians chapter 5? It's a very serious problem. A man has his father's wife, and the congregation thinks they're puffed up enough. They've got enough knowledge and holiness and righteousness that they can allow that to go on and overlook it and say, we're still okay with God. And God says, that's not acceptable. You need to put that ungodly person out from among your midst. Notice the words of 1 Corinthians 5 and verse 1. Paul says to the church in Corinth, it's actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and such sexual immorality is not even named among the Gentiles, that a man has his father's wife. Here is a Christian man who is now in a sexual relationship with his mother-in-law. Now, my friends, that's a very serious problem. His father's wife, his stepmother, may be even the case. And so here's a man who has his stepmother as his wife, and that is causing gross immorality in the church at Corinth. Now, friends, as we think about this problem, this was a sinful action because based on God's principles, going all the way back into the Old Testament, this was something that God clearly condemned. In fact, it was something that was worthy of death. Look in Leviticus chapter 20 and verse 11. And I want you to notice what the Scripture says about this. Under the old law, God said, the man who lies with his father's wife has uncovered his father's nakedness, both of them shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. My friends, this was a type of incest considered by God, and it was something that was punishable by death. And so this was a very serious sin, but the problem is, he has her. That is, he's living with her, they're sleeping together, they're having sexual relations, and this is causing sexual immorality in the church. Above all that, there is the adultery. If the father is alive and they're divorced or otherwise, then it's a sense of adultery going on there. And so these are serious problems that the church in Corinth is facing. One of the main problems is the church in Corinth hadn't responded properly to this immorality. They're puffed up. They think that they can just overlook it. And Paul says, you should have been mourning. 1 Corinthians 5 verse 2, you're puffed up, Paul says. You should have been mourning, and this ungodly man should have been put out of the assembly. Friends, we can never allow sin to go on in the church and think we can overlook it. If someone's involved in a relationship that's not right, in a wrong marriage, if they're involved in adulterous practices and sinful sexual relationships, we need to deal with that. If people are involved in sins, gambling, drinking, alcohol, whatever that may be, we need to deal with those problems. We can't just say to ourselves, well, we can allow him to go here, and we won't let him wait on the table, or we won't let him do this. We know he's in sin, but we're still going to allow him to attend here. Now, we want people to hear the gospel, but to be in fellowship and be an active part of the congregation, such is clearly condemned in Scripture. And so Paul makes it clear to these people. The application is very simple. God says, you need to deal with this. I've already decided on the matter. We can't let these people live in sin. You take care of it. That is what the Corinthians were doing, and thus elders and leaders must take charge and disfellowship those who are living immorally. You know, if we're going to be people who follow the Bible, we've got to follow all that it says. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, the Scriptures clearly teach that where immoral actions exist, where sin is persistent and people are in rebellion, will not deal with the sin problem in a God-approved way, then elders and leaders in charge to follow God's commands must be willing to disfellowship those who are in sin. A failure to do so is in essence saying we're better than God and we can overlook that. Even if God doesn't like it, we can deal with it and let that go on. You see, my friends, it's imperative that as Christians, we make judgments on matters of morals and doctrine. There are some who say you can't judge. Paul said, I've already judged. I've already made up my mind on this situation. God's already decided on it, and I've made the judgment. Some people say today that you can't judge, and if you do, you're sinning. They quote Matthew 7:1, judge not lest you be judged. The context of Matthew 7:1 is not about making decisions on morals and doctrine. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 is dealing with the hypocritical Jews who would say to others, you do this, and then they go do something different. It deals with hypocritical judging, telling someone else to do right, and you then going and doing wrong. That's the kind of hypocritical judging that Jesus condemned. But be sure the Scriptures teach us we must make judgments on morals and on doctrine. I want you to notice the words of John 7 and verse 24. Look at what the Lord said here. Jesus said, do not judge according to appearance, but judge with a righteous judgment. Friends, we have to be brave enough, have to have the courage and the boldness to stand up and say, you're living in sin, we love you, and we want you to go to heaven. And the Scripture says that's wrong. And we're going to have to disfellowship you for the sake of your soul if you're not willing to make it right. Do we want to do that? Not in the sense that we want to make someone feel like they've been punished for no reason, but do we want to because it'll save their soul and because God said so? Absolutely. Now, how does a person then make a righteous judgment? Jesus said, don't judge according to appearance. Don't just look at it and say it's wrong. Judge with a righteous judgment. How do you do that? The Bible teaches that a righteous judgment is always based on the Word of God. Psalm 119, verses 160 through 172, the passages there over and over again teach all of God's commandments are righteous. John 12 and verse 48, we're going to be judged by the righteous words of Christ. And so to make a righteous judgment, we come to the Scriptures. This kind of action is clearly condemned, and thus we stand up and say what God has already said. And in essence, we're really not being the judge. God's already made the decision. We're just saying what He said and enforcing that. And so should a person who's living in an immoral lifestyle, involved in sin and won't repent of it, should they be disfellowshipped? Yes, the Scripture teaches by Christ's authority, by the Spirit of Christ, we must be willing to put those people out of the assembly. Notice the clear teaching of 1 Corinthians 5, verses 4 and 5. The Scripture says this. Paul said, here's what I want you to do. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together along with my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. The point is clear here. If you're going to follow the authority of God, the Spirit of Christ, Colossians 3:17, you've got to, in truth and love, Ephesians 4:15, withdraw from this person. When you come together in my spirit, by my authority, which the authority of Paul, 1 Corinthians 14, verse 37, came from God and the Holy Spirit, we must be willing. When we come together and people are in sin in the assembly, we must be willing to disfellowship them for the sake of their soul. Think about the example of Jesus and Peter. Jesus clearly told Peter, you're going to deny me. And Peter did that. But you know what? Peter realized his sin. Jesus pointed it out to him, and Peter was given a chance to come back. Now, we're not saying you have to disfellowship these people and can't ever have anything to do with them. Scripture teaches we admonish them as a brother. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and 3 teaches that. But we also want them to go to heaven enough that we're willing to follow through with these procedures. And notice verse 5 again. We may deliver their flesh up to be destroyed, but it's for the saving of the soul. We want them to stop their sinful actions in the flesh so that they can save their soul. You know what's amazing about disfellowship is it's not a mean thing. The Scripture teaches it is the kindest thing you could do to somebody who's in sin because you're more concerned about their soul at that point than they are. Now, what's the proper action against this? Notice, I want you to notice from these three passages, I want you to see what Paul says the congregation was to do. Notice his encouragement in 1 Corinthians 5 in dealing with this. In verse 5, he says, I want you to deliver such a one to Satan. Verse 7, purge out the old leaven. Get rid of it. Verse 11, don't keep company with anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral. And in verse 11, don't eat with such a person. So you purge it out. You disfellowship them. You don't have anything to do with them. You take them out from among the fellowship of the church. 1 Timothy 1, verse 20, Paul delivered Hymenaeus and Alexander to Satan that they may learn not to blaspheme. And friends, we need to do the same today. But the interesting thing about disfellowship is it's not always for some heinous sexual sin. You read 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, and Paul is there talking about disfellowshipping certain people. And do you know why? Laziness. They had quit working. They were staring up in the sky, thinking Jesus is going to come at any moment, it seems like. And they just given up their jobs, quit taking care of the family, and quit working. Why was he about to disfellowship some there? Because of laziness. And so when one remains in persistent sin, hardens at heart, and rebels against the will of God, that person, for the sake of his soul, needs to be disfellowshipped. Now, what is the purpose of disfellowship? It's not just to save that person's soul. It's to take a stand against sin. Friend, God always takes the right stand against sin in Scripture. He tells us what it does to us. Wages of sin is death, Romans 6, verse 23. He tells us what it does to our relationship with Him. It separates that, Isaiah 59, 1 and 2. And He tells us the end result of that. Mark chapter 9, verse 44, we'll be cast into the lake of fire, into hell itself. And so it is to take a stand against sin, so that people aren't lost. If people see you, see congregation stand up for what's right, they're going to think twice about getting involved in that sin again. It's also for the saving of the sinner's soul. And you know what? It works. Have you read 2 Corinthians 2, verses 5 through 11? You know that man in 1 Corinthians 5 we've been talking about? Well, they followed Paul's actions. And they disfellowshipped that brother. And Paul now has to write to them in 2 Corinthians 2, verses 5 through 11. He says, you've disfellowshipped him. It looks like in the context he's repented. He says, I want you to receive him back in love and don't put too much on him. He repented. He changed his ways. It worked. Maybe more people are going to be lost today because we're not following what the Bible says on disfellowship. Is it popular? Oh, no. It's not popular with society at all. Does it make people feel good in a physical, emotional sense? Not at all. But is it the right thing to do to take a stand against sin and to help people get to heaven? Friend, it's the only way when someone is that steeped in sin to actually reach them at that point. And so we must do it to follow God's directives on this. Now, another reason Paul offers for this fellowship is to salvage the rest of the congregation. You read 1 Corinthians 5, verse 6, and Paul says a little leaven's going to leaven the whole lump. You can take a rotten apple, put it in the bottle of a bushel of good apples, and before you know it, the whole bushel's gone bad. My friends, disfellowship also is a preventative for other people getting involved in sin. What a message it sends to other members. When someone got involved in sin and we took it seriously, we tried to save their soul, it sends a message that the leaders of the local congregation don't want anybody to go to hell and they're not going to put up with sin. If you get involved in that, you can be sure there are going to be repercussions spiritually. Now, friends, as we think about disfellowship, sometimes people will say, you know, we ought to do disfellowship, but they'll still remain in a relationship, it seems like, with the people who were disfellowshipped. To make disfellowship work, Christians have to choose, after the disfellowship occurs, choose not to have close associations with these people who've been disfellowshipped. We have to make it work by following the principles set out, and that means we no longer fellowship with these people. Notice what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 5, verses 9 and 10. Paul said this, I wrote to you in my epistle not to keep company with sexually immoral people. Yet I certainly did not mean with sexually immoral people of this world, or with the covetous, or extortioners, or idolaters, since you would need to go out of the world. Paul says here, I don't even want you to keep company with those people. Verse 11, he's going to say, you don't even eat with a brother who's done those type of things. Why? Here's why. Number one, it tells them we mean what we said, and we hope you'll get your soul right. But there's another reason, and that is if you run with those who do ungodly things, my friends, they may influence you. Someone's rightly said that if you run with the goats, you may begin to smell like him before long. We need to stay away from sin and stay away from those who are in sin, lest their evil deeds rub off on us. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33, evil companions corrupt good morals. And so Paul's teaching here is very clear, and we must be willing to follow that. But why is it? Why is it that congregations, the Lord's church, and people who claim to follow the Bible are not willing to go through with disfellowship? Here's why. The main reason is we're cowards. We will not stand up for what God has said, and we say to ourselves it won't work. Friends, it doesn't matter whether we think it'll work or not. 2 Corinthians 2 says it did work, and we need to have the courage to stand up and do what God said, and we need to stop worrying about, will this offend that person? Will it drive them further away? How can you drive them further away than they already are? Is it going to offend them? I hope it does offend them, because their sin offends God, and maybe it'll make them think about the fact that what they're doing is offensive to God and the church and how they've offended others. Maybe it'll cause them to reason in their own mind that this is not right. And so let's stop being cowardice. Let's stop worrying about if we're going to push people away who are already away, and let's put in practice what God, by the Holy Spirit, has said, the only way it will work to bring someone back. Now, when you look then in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, we've dealt with sins against the body, dealing with sexual morality, but here's a sin against the body of Christ, and that is certain Christians in 1 Corinthians 6, verses 1 through 8, are suing one another. And Paul says, you don't need to do that. That's going to bring a bad testimony for the Lord. Notice 1 Corinthians 6, verse 1. Paul says, dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Paul says, why in the world, if you've got problems, do you want to take those problems before the world when we're supposed to be the light to the world? It presents a bad testimony for the Lord when we have to go to a carnal, worldly, often pagan court to find out what we want, how we can solve our problems. The congregation, Paul says, has failed to live up to its full position in Christ where they ought to be, and the members suing one another. Here's what Paul says in verse 7. The members suing one another have already lost. If two Christians goes to court, do you know who loses? Both of them. Both of them and Christ and the testimony of the church and the example we can have to the world. If all else fails, Paul says, you need to accept wrong and be defrauded rather than going before a heathen court. What did Jesus say in Matthew 5, verse 40? Didn't He say something like that? Listen to the words of Christ in Matthew 5, verse 40. Jesus said, if anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, let him have your cloak also. Jesus said, you go the extra mile. If someone wants to sue you and says, I want your coat, you say, well, here, you can have my shirt too. I don't want to do that. I don't want to go through this procedure with you and give a bad testimony for the Lord, especially. Why would two Christians do that? And so we must be willing to go the extra mile to live up to Christian principles. And you know, where two people are involved in problems like that, there's sin somewhere, and somebody's not having the love of Christ like they ought to in their life. Now, in 1 Corinthians 6, Paul also deals with some more sins against the physical body. One of the lessons Paul teaches us is that to be faithful to God and to really go to heaven, you've got to abandon certain sinful actions, especially related to immorality. What are some of the things the people in Corinth were involved in before they became Christians? Notice 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 through 11. Paul says this, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were, notice the tense, such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. If we're going to be faithful to God, Paul said, you cannot live in these sins. Sexual morality, fornication, illicit sexual activity, adultery, having some other man's wife or husband, idolatry, and notice what else he says. Homosexuality. Friend, make it clear in your mind that these people, Paul says, will not inherit the kingdom of God. What's that mean? Sodomites, fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, and yes, Homosexuals, the Bible says, will not go to heaven if they remain in that relationship. Now, a lot of people are saying, well, they were born that way. If God says they can't practice that and go to heaven, then how can they be born that way, created that way by God Himself? Surely it's a choice, as the Scripture teaches. We have the choice to make, Joshua 24. And thus, these actions are sinful in God's sight. But here's what God does expect. God expects me, and He expects you. He expects us to control ourselves. I have the ability to control myself. Look at the words of 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12. In light of these sins that they were in, Paul telling them, you've got out of them, such were some of you. He makes the point that you can control yourself. You don't have to go back into that. Notice verse 12. Paul says, all things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I'll not be brought under the power of any. Now, in the sense of lawful, it may not be against the law of God, it may not be against the law of man, but it may not be the best thing for you. You don't need to be brought under the power of something if that is going to control and rule your life. I'll not be brought under the power of any. Proverbs 25 and verse 28 teaches us, like a city whose walls are broken down is a man who lacks self-control. Imagine a city in your mind, and for its protection they have a wall around it, and that wall is crumbling down everywhere, and there are holes in it. How well would that protect the city? Here's the point. Just like that city whose walls are broken down, the man who lacks self-control is just like that. 1 Peter 2:11 teaches us we're to abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. We're not to have anything to do with those actions. In fact, in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 18, Paul says you need to flee sexual immorality. To Timothy, Paul said in 2 Timothy 2, verse 22, flee youthful lust. It is a sin against your own body, verse 18, and apart from the spiritual consequences, think about the physical consequences of this. What will sexual immorality really get you in this life? I tell you what it might get you. It might get you an STD. It might make you a parent before you desire to be. It'll bring you a lot of heartache and emotional baggage, but it won't help you get to heaven. You know what? It won't make you happy. It won't provide you with real love. You need to flee sexual immorality. Abstain from every fleshly lust which wars against the soul. And as Paul said, young people, listen especially, you need to flee youthful lust. You can control your desires and passions if you decide to put your energy in the right places, into serving God, into His kingdom, and making the most of everything God wants you to be. Now, here's a passage I hope you'll never forget. 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19, 20 is really the basis and the foundation for everything we've said today. Why is it that I must not get involved in sexually immoral sins? Why is it that we must put those out of the kingdom of God who are not living right? Why is it these people had to come out of gross immorality and use self-control? Here's the basis and foundation of that all. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and you belong to God now. When you obey the gospel, you no longer are your own. You're God's. Look at 1 Corinthians 6. Notice the words of verses 19 and 20. Paul says, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you are bought at a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Who does my body and my spirit belong to? It belongs to God. You're not your own. Hear those words. We, when we obey the gospel, do not belong to ourselves anymore. Christ paid the ultimate price. Acts 20, verse 28. He purchased the church with His own blood, and it's by His stripes. Isaiah 53, verse 4, 1 Peter 2, verse 24, that I'm healed. He paid the debt. He ransomed me back from the devil. Galatians 1, verse 4. And thus, I belong to Christ. As a result of that, I can no longer live in sin. I believe that a lot of people have a lack of commitment because they haven't taken that phrase to heart. You're not your own. Friend, take it to heart today. You don't belong to yourself anymore. In Romans 12, verse 2, verses 1 and 2, Paul said, I beg you, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. We are a living sacrifice to God. You know, life's not about me, and it's not about you when I obey the gospel. Isaiah 43, verse 7, God said, "Everyone who's called by my name, whom I have created for my glory, I formed him, yes, I've made him." Paul said in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31, "Whether we eat or whether we drink or whatever we do, we're to do all to the glory of God." And would you hear the words of the wise Solomon? Solomon, the man who had the most wisdom ever, according to 1 Kings 5, and yet he squandered that on sinful practices and later wrote these words. Here's what the wisest man ever said about life. Let's hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God. Keep His commandments. This is the whole duty of man. Why? For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or bad. I need to make sure that I fear God, that I respect Him as God, and that I obey His commandments, and that's my whole duty. That's what life is all about. Life is not about money. Life's not about achievements. Life's not about degrees. Life is about me fearing God and keeping His commandments. And friend, realize the reason we need to do that is that you were bought at an awful price. 1 John 2, verse 2, He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. When Jesus cried out in Matthew 27, verse 46, my God, why have you forsaken me? Do you know what the answer is to that question? Me and you. Jesus was forsaken by God because He bore my sins and yours in His own body. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21, God made Christ who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf. That being the case, Habakkuk 1, verse 13 says that God's a pure eyes and cannot behold or look upon evil. Look at the awful price that was paid so that you could have access to salvation. And so, friend, we ask you, are you avoiding sins in the body that cause problems in the church? Are you involved in sexual immorality? Have you done things to other members that you know are not right? Have you really changed your life, and are you living a life that has self-control in it? If not, you're sinning against the body, your own body and the body of Christ. And we encourage you today to make that right. Maybe you've never obeyed the gospel. Maybe you've never realized just what Christ did for you. Friend, there's no time like the present to obey God's will. If you've heard the Word, you know that Jesus is the Son of God, you believe that, you're willing to repent of those things in your life that are not right, and you're willing to confess before men Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, you can be baptized for the remission of your sins. In Acts 22:16, Ananias came to Saul and said, "Saul, Saul, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins." Friends, may each of us live every day to give our body and our life to Christ according to His gospel. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wallet.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905 or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee,